This is going to go back to my high school talent show. Okay. It's like, all right, I want to do something different.
Yeah.
All right. So if you're familiar with the number pi, right?
Yeah.
Let me memorize some digits of pi. So what I ended up doing was I memorized 200 digits of pi, 3.14159265.
Guys, welcome to True Talk. We had a special guest in the house today, Micah Dirkers. How we doing, Micah?
Doing well. How's it going?
Awesome, dude. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Mike.
So you're like right up the road a little bit, right?
Providence, Rhode Island.
Nice. About an hour?
Hour away, hour
nice
drive.
Ride down.
Nice and smooth this morning.
Awesome. Well, we're going to talk about a few things today. You know what? The thing about our business, Mike, is sometimes we get so set on talking about all the good. Mm-hmm. It's a great industry, right? But it's not perfect.
Absolutely.
And there's ups and downs in every industry, and you've been through ups and downs. I know you shared some stuff earlier that we're going to get into. You know, I get calls, Micah, like once a week, right? Mm-hmm. My agent rolled me debt. What do I do? It's like people are shocked. Like, oh, my God, debt rolled up. Like, that's part of the business. It's not the best part of the business, but it is part. Like, if you have a convenience store, someone's going to steal some stuff, right?
Yep.
And there's a certain kind of threshold that you're just going to allow. You know, steal candy bar here and there, sure. But, you know, they're back stealing lottery tickets or, you know, cases of beer or something. There's a problem, yep, right?
Absolutely.
So it is part of the industry. You've gone through some of that, right? I know you had one fairly recent, right? Was it close to 75,000 that was maybe rolled up? Or
yeah, so here's what ended up happening. So this was actually back last year.
Okay.
I hired someone off of LinkedIn.
Yeah.
And for a while, things were going really strong, right? He was consistent top producer on the team. Everything was going well. But he ran into some personal challenges, and I think what ended up happening was cutting some corners, using some lead vendors that weren't authorized.
Yeah.
You know, and what ended up happening was tons of policies getting written without even his awareness, because he,
Got it. Quite frankly,
was doing some things he wasn't supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And what ended up happening was, you know, he was hovering around, you know, 20, 30 families a month.
Yeah.
And then, you know, next month's IP report came out and that was like 50, 60, 70. And I was like, that's kind of strange.
Right.
Right. And at the time, I didn't think too much about it. Number one, because I didn't really have a ton of training about how to minimize risk. But also, like, I trusted this guy.
Yeah.
Right. And so what I ended up finding down the road, you know, okay, I started looking at the policies. Some draft dates were pushed out pretty far.
Yeah.
On all of them. There are a lot of policies that I never really see being written, like America Eagle Premier Guaranteed, right? That's really not something that most agents write.
Right.
But there was a lot of that, and I was like, that's kind of weird. So what ended up happening is the vast majority of those policies ended up charging back, falling off the books. America caught that, you know, wrong socials, wrong addresses, wrong bank accounts, terminated.
No fraud, bunch of fraud.
Absolutely. And so that was my first real experience with a big chunk of roll-up debt.
How at this point, Micah, how long were you in the business for?
So that happened in summer of 2022.
Okay.
Okay. I joined, my first full month was January of 2021.
Of FFL.
So it was about a month and a year and a half.
Okay.
Year and a half in. So
were you in the industry prior to joining us?
Yep. I was at a practice company, basically just representing one carrier, one product.
Got it. How long were you there for?
Was there for 4 months.
Okay.
And didn't really do too well, was literally at the bottom of the totem pole.
Got it.
And when I came into this company, I thought to myself, well, you know, maybe I can do better than I did there.
Yeah.
And fortunately, that was a very low bar, but we ended up making that happen.
Right.
Right. One thing I will say, though, is that my practice company was really good on training, especially with risk mitigation and control of debt. When I came over here, that's not something that I was really trained on that much. And I was just, you know, focusing on my own business, focusing on building. And because I would never even think of writing a fraudulent policy at all, I wasn't aware of the signs that I would look for if somebody were doing that, right? So that was a bit of a wake-up call last year.
And I think that's a key point, because human nature, we tend to treat people, you know, treat people the way you want to be treated.
Right?
And we think people think like us. And it's like, if I wouldn't do it, God, I would never think you would do it. And
right.
That's when you're in this business, you meet all types of people. Most of them are not going to be like you.
Absolutely.
You know? Fortunately or unfortunately at times. So then we get into these situations. So you were, I mean, a couple of years barely in the business.
Right.
And was this your first real debt that you had to deal with?
First real debt. Yeah. Absolutely. Outside of, you know, your minor, you know, one or two policies charged back,
right.
The agent takes care of it. No big deal. Right.
Yeah.
But in terms of rolled debt, it was approximately 30 roughly with Americo.
Yeah.
About 10 with Aetna and 10 with Prosperity.
Wow. And it's all hit at once or pretty much?
No. So fortunately, with communication with the carriers, we were able to spread it out. America was obviously the biggest, terminated right away. So that rolls up.
Gotcha.
Naturally, when someone's broke, they really don't, they're not able to get on a payment plan or pay that. Right. So that hit my account pretty quickly.
What were you thinking when you realized, like, wow, $75,000 in total, kind of like that? What was going through your mind at that point when you first got hit with it?
Yeah. When I first got hit with it, I thought to myself, damn, this is, I didn't think this would happen to me.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, you know what? I try to be trusting. I try to look at the right people. I try to know my business really well, but it was a blind spot, right? We don't know what we don't know.
Right.
Right. And so when I saw that, I thought to myself, okay, well, this is going to be a challenge for me. I know I can get through it. Other people have gotten through it. Other people have built businesses and talked about their, how this has shaped them. Yeah. Right. And so it was a little bit of a challenge for me. I was definitely intimidated. Yeah. Absolutely. And especially as a smaller agency owner, dealing with something like that, I thought to myself, well, listen, I'm not going to be getting a huge bonus to take care of this.
Mm.
You know, team around that point was around, you know, 150 families a month, 175 families a month. So I knew that I was going to get through it, but I also know how to write business. And the biggest thing was just staying in touch with the carriers.
Yeah.
Right. And fortunately, America was extremely communicative and very willing to work with us with respect to that. So spreading that out, updating payment plans, new business and individual payments, we got through it.
Yeah. How long did it take you to get through the entire
debt? So the entire thing, and I'm going to speak about America first because the different carriers spread it out differently, right? So the America debt, I actually fully cleared, last month.
Okay.
Okay. So August 1st, that was done.
Yeah.
Okay. And that felt great.
They'll say, what did that feel like in comparison to when you got it?
Well, it was great because, you know, at least with Americo, they allow you to set up a repayment plan. Basically, what that means, if you guys aren't familiar with it, you can take, you know, 50% of your commissions and have it paid toward the debt, 50% get paid to you.
Yeah.
Right? So what ended up happening was I did a 75% repayment plan because I wanted it to go down.
Yeah.
Right? And so it took a while, you know, and I use all the carriers in our portfolio where appropriate, right? So I use Americo here. I use Prosperity Aetna here. So it's not like I was funneling all my business through Americo, which is why it took me probably, you know, 10 months to a year to clear that.
Yeah.
But we got it done. And I always stayed on top of that, right? So making sure that I was always placing that business with the carrier when appropriate for the client was the best way to get through that and communicate with Americo, let them know, hey, this is what's going on. We're making these payments. You see the quality of business. Retention's at 93%. Like, we're okay. We're going to make it through this, right? So that's probably the biggest thing. That happened first. Prosperity took about 4 to 5 months to roll up. And then Aetna took actually close to 10 to 11 months, and I should be clear of that this week.
Gotcha.
Or next week, roughly.
What's funny, Mike, I get these calls, right? And their question is usually based – they're looking for some outside – magic almost. Yep. Like, what do we do? Who's the collection agency? What attorney do we send it to? What I'm like, the easiest way or the simplest way is what you did. Work with the carriers, come up with a repayment plan, and then outright it.
Right.
Because we have a handful of carriers. So I only write America and it's gonna eat up all my debt. Well, first of all, you shouldn't only write one carrier.
Right.
You should mix it up. And as long as you're in communication, that's the key. You're in communication with the carriers, they're going to work with you. Here's when they're not gonna work with you. When you don't respond, when they reach out and they go, hey, Micah, you're supposed to set up a payment plan by this time. You didn't, right? And then they want full repayment.
Exactly. Because, look, they're a business as well. They're advancing us this money. If they don't get it, they're at a loss. They have to keep their books in order for their investors. And so it's in their interest to work with us to get that paid down. It's a win-win as long as we're reasonable.
Absolutely.
Right? So, but I want to go back to something you said there, Mike. Yeah. So dealing with it is one thing. But I think what I've really learned in this last year is how to address it preventatively, right? Because I don't want to have that happen again. And I know that it, you know, I can't make sure that's perfect. And, you know, policies are going to fall off. That's normal in this line of work. But what we can prevent is those big balloons of debt that just go up.
Yeah, like with this agent, what type of vetting was done when you recruited him?
Not that much.
Yeah.
And that's my fault.
Yeah.
Right. I hired him.
And I love you for saying that. Because you know, most people go, well, he's just an ass. He was this, he was
right.
that.
Right. And look,
all that's maybe true.
Right.
But like you said, it was my fault.
And it's always a two-way street, right? Did he do things that were fraudulent? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Is that his problem? Absolutely. Will he be held accountable? Absolutely. But it's also my responsibility for not recognizing the signs, not taking action.
Were there red flags that you ignored?
Looking back now, yes.
Yeah.
At the time, I just thought, oh, well, he found out a new way to write some more business, right? So everything's special, good.
Right?
I'm sure if there were problems, America, you know, they put a stop to it right away. But I learned that it takes time for them to find that stuff as well, right? Because these are people, right? They have to check, hey, does this match up? Does this match up? So what I'm doing now, okay, quality control calls for new policies that come through the pipeline if anything looks suspicious, okay? If we have an agent that has a big jump in production, we want to review that, right? Maybe they did. Hey, we just invested more. You know, we hit a big annuity, whatever the case may be. There's nothing wrong with increasing your production. Right. That's what we want. But there are times where if you're not careful, those jumps in production may be a sign of something going on.
Absolutely.
You know?
And what's hurt to check, dude? I mean, call some clients. Like, there's so many steps before it gets to that 75K, right? That, like you said, there's these red flags that we do ignore for several reasons. First of all, like you said, we're trying to grow volume.
Right.
So part of you is excited that, hey, I got this guy. He's
helping
25 families a month. Now he's jumping up to 50, a little nervous. But, hey, he's helping more family. He's making money. We're making money. Everyone's happy. And it's like I call it the honeymoon phase.
Mm-hmm.
We get in a honeymoon phase with agents. We get like these little red flags that we just ignore, and then they compound, and then when it all hits, shit hits the fan. All of a sudden, 75K like this. It feels like it happened overnight, but in reality, we didn't vet them properly.
Right.
I trust them too much. Right.
Right.
I ignored this red flag,
right.
And when the production, I didn't ask them about it. I never called his clients. All these things multiply.
Well, and here's another thing I've learned as well. And this is delicate, right? Because we're all 1099, right?
Absolutely.
And it's not like we're forcing people to be on Zoom, for example, or to work specific hours. But what I have noticed is that when people don't communicate, not only with the carriers, but with the team, and they're just off doing their own thing, that's room for them to do whatever they want to do because there's no oversight, right?
Yeah.
If you're on Zoom and I see you dialing, right, and you can unmute and I hear a real person on the phone that you're talking to, I know that, you know, we're good.
Yeah.
Right. But if I don't see you at all and then magically boom, it's going to trigger a red flag now that I wish I had known earlier. And so for those of you out there who might be newer in the business, do some quality control calls.
Yeah.
Check the new policies that are coming through the pipeline. Make sure that you touch base with your key players and make sure that, hey, like, are you writing like actual leads?
Right.
Like, where are these people coming from? And listen, I love referrals, but sometimes if it's only referrals, you have to ask yourself, well, where are these people coming from?
Absolutely.
And there's a process to getting them, right? Beneficiaries, emergency contacts, family members.
Yep.
We love that, right? More policies, more retention, but just play defense as well as a good offense.
Right. And if your agent's not doing anything wrong, like no agent who is not committing fraud, who's taking care of clients the way they're supposed to, is going to be concerned about you looking into their business.
Absolutely.
The guy who goes, don't look into my business, is the business you want to look into.
Right.
Because I wouldn't call my clients. Back in the day, you could have called every single one of my clients. I don't care. Because I know what I'm doing is right.
Right.
You can call them up and go, hey, did Mike help you out with this policy? He put, yes, absolutely. Came to my house. We signed. We agreed to. Boom.
Yep.
You're never going to get, no, I never met Mike. Somehow I got an application in the mail. So if you even bring that up to an agent and they get nervous, you should be nervous.
Absolutely. And listen, I wish I had known that because the excuse that was given to me at the time was, oh, well, I'm just a private person. I don't feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Right. And listen, I'm a fairly private person as well.
Right.
Right. Like I kind of do my own thing, but call every client I have.
You're also not committing fraud.
Right. Right. You know? And so and it's tough. It's what we were talking about earlier with a little bit of self-awareness, right?
Yeah.
Because when you know that you would never do something like that, how do you fathom somebody who does that, right? And it's a wake-up call because you have to realize that, hey, there are lots of different people out there. Not everybody's holding themselves to the same standards. So, again, play defensive.
Yeah.
And here's another thing, right? I was never told for my first year and a half that I could actually request that somebody be placed on as earned, which means they're only paid once the client makes their premium payment every single month. So there's no advance commission, right? So once I figured out, oh, wait a second, somebody, I can actually put somebody on as earned. Well, that's a great way to mitigate any fraud because this all comes from the difference between, you know, money being advanced and then clients don't pay.
Sure.
Right. And I know as a company, we moved to pay on settle, you know, recently, which is awesome. Right. And that's cutting down a
which
large
avoids
of
what you were talking about with all these post-dated, you know, policies.
Exactly.
I get it, dude. There's every once in a while, there's a client where they're in a situation. I don't get this check till this day. I really want it. But those are like one-offs. It's
right.
Not, it shouldn't be, 25% of your business. It should be 5 or 10 at
exactly.
tops.
And you have to ask yourself, too, if you're sitting with that client, and let's say it's whatever, even September 5th,
yep.
right? We're sitting with the client, hey, I spent all my money. I don't get my Social Security, my next check till whatever, October 1st. Can we set the policy there? Maybe, but the question I want to ask is, well, why don't you have any money?
Right.
Right? Are your expenses so tight that if we add this in, you know, the first of the month comes along that now we're going to be back down to zero? So you really want to be smart with your budgeting. And look, if you have to push it out, you push it out. Right?
That's a good point, though. Vet it. Don't just the minute they go, can it come out next month? Yeah, sure, no problem.
Right.
But let's find out why.
Right.
Does it really need to come out next month? What if it came out next week? Can
exactly.
we do that? You know, can we figure out something? Because this payment's going to be every month.
Exactly.
And, you know, you mentioned the pay. Like, I think sometimes we agents get so tunnel vision with their commissions. Like, they paid me. Well, they loaned you.
Correct.
Look at your commission as a loan. Because guess what? Policy doesn't make it a full year. You owe that money back. I'm not the expert on what's in the Webster Dictionary, but that sounds like a loan to me, right?
Correct.
I give you some money that you don't hold up your client doesn't hold their end of the bargain. You now owe it back to me. I loaned you money.
Right. Which, and another way, Mike, to be defensive in this business is just have a chargeback fund, right? Put money in there
Absolutely.
And don't touch it because it's going to happen.
Yep.
Whether it's a personal policy of yours or an agent policy, you will need to use that. And look, good for you if you go a year or two without needing it, then do what you want with
right.
it. But have some basic protection for yourself. And again, be defensive, but also be offensive. Go write business, but protect yourself.
Absolutely.
Cover all the
these
bases.
Are questions we should ask while we're recruiting. You know, I love Zach Twardowski asked the new agent. He doesn't say if. He goes, when, Micah, when you spend $1,000 on leads and you don't help any families, what are you going to do in that situation? Like, that's going to happen. It will happen at some point.
Absolutely.
You've been there, right? How many, have you not had a week where you bought X amount of dollars in leads and I helped the family?
I'll tell you a little story here. So this was last year. During the summer, I bought a batch of leads and then I had combed through some old leads. I sorted by city and I was like, all right, I'm just going to work this city and just see if I can follow up with as many people as possible. It was a Wednesday and a Tuesday, Wednesday. I had booked 15 appointments over those 2 days. I sat with three of them.
Yeah.
Closed zero.
Wow.
And it was a whole variety of leads too, fresher stuff, older stuff. And I thought to myself, like, what's going on? Like, is it the time of year? Is it me? Like, what is this, something in the water? Because usually I'm used to being pretty consistent.
Yeah.
But we all have weeks when that doesn't happen. You have to ask yourself, can I keep going?
Right.
And something that I have started to implement in my recruiting as well is asking that same question, not from a lead spend perspective, but from a debt perspective. Hey, if you have – this happened to one of my agents. Really nice lady, closed two policies for her big policies – you know, 3 weeks later, hey, sorry, I can't afford it. Done, right?
Yeah.
Charge back. So it comes down to, hey, if this happens to you, can you deal with it? And like we've heard before in other podcasts, we want to make sure they know the risks. I would even say more so than the benefits to see if they're actually going to stick.
Mm-hmm.
Because to me, the upside is far greater than the downside, but there is a very significant downside as well. Where if you don't play defensively and you don't have someone to show you those ropes, it can end up taking you out.
Absolutely.
And I've seen it happen.
And it's almost like, you know, you got to approach this business where not, you know, if I get some debt, you're going to have debt rolled to you at some point.
Yeah.
I don't know that you're going to have 75,000 like Micah. You may have more, you may have less, but there's not every agent that you recruit is going to stay with you forever.
Absolutely.
Not every agent's going to have good quality business. Not every agent's going to take care of their own debt. The truth. It's
absolutely
part of the business. There's ups and downs.
Absolutely. And I think one thing I want to say as well that has helped me get through this is just a mindset that, hey, this is happening for me to teach me a lesson.
Yes.
Okay. This isn't happening to me. Okay. Yeah, I'm dealing with it, but what can I learn from this?
Right.
And that's what's going to make me stronger
down
the road. It's what's going to teach me about quality control, risk and loss prevention, and making sure that I can show that to my agents so that they don't have to go through the same thing, or at least if they do, it's minimized.
Yeah.
Right?
It takes a level of accountability, a level of self-awareness. I know you said this earlier before we were on air, but self-awareness is so important I think life in general, you go to this industry, I think in any industry, I think to get to a certain level of success or a level of achievement, you need to be self-aware. You need to take accountability for things that may not even be your fault. Like this, you didn't create the fraud or the debt, but it's like you could do, you could look at it two ways. Mm-hmm. You could blame it all on the agent. Mm-hmm. And then guess what? You change nothing. Mm-hmm. And then you're going to recruit another agent and you're going to do the same thing. Mm-hmm. And then it's going to be that agent. And then you're going to go, it's LinkedIn. Whenever I use LinkedIn, I get these bad. Like, I love that. Like, I don't want to recruit in this state because whenever I recruit someone from this area, they commit fraud. Like, oh, that's what it is. It's not
great.
You,
so that must mean all the agents in that state are just bad apples, right? Like, listen to yourself.
Yeah, 100%. It's like the leads, right? Well, every time I run leads in Rhode Island, Mike, I struggle. Like,
right.
Oh, it must just be Rhode Island people, Mike. You're just better in Connecticut.
Right.
But it's a self-aware. Now, were you always self-aware, though?
That's been one of my strengths. Okay. It's definitely changed over the years.
Yeah.
It's actually what I wrote my college essay about.
Really?
Because I do think that's something that I've always strived for, right? Yeah. Definitely not perfect. There's a lot that I miss.
Yeah.
And there's a lot, like if you had seen me 2 years ago, 3 years ago actually now, at my practice company, you would have been like, this guy has no chance here at all. You know, was not confident, didn't know what I was saying, didn't know anything about sales. But what I did know is that, you know what, if I put my mind to something, I'm going to figure it out.
Yeah.
And I really believe that. And that's why even if I try a new lead source or try a new lead vendor, I know I will make my money back.
Yeah.
I know that.
Yeah.
Because I've, like, how could I fail?
Right.
In that respect. That doesn't mean, you know, every single time, every single order is profitable. But on the whole, it is.
Yeah.
You know? So I think confidence in yourself is extremely important. And self-awareness is really, in my opinion, the core of this business because you have to know your numbers. You have to know yourself.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to help you know your clients, and that's going to help you know your agents and the team. Again, doesn't mean we're perfect. There's a lot of stuff I miss. And sometimes, you know, I get in my head about things and I come across as like, you know, in my own world.
Absolutely.
Right? And I'm not afraid to admit that. But I also know that I'm working on that. And as long as my team knows that and there's progress, it's good.
Right.
You know?
And if you're not self-aware, it's hard because, like, if you're not self-aware, I guess you wouldn't know, right? But it's kind of like the old saying, like, people that are stupid and dead don't know they're stupid or dead, right? Like, if you're not self-aware, you don't know you're not self-aware.
Right.
But, you know, what you should do in general is surround yourself with people that will tell you the truth.
Absolutely.
And it's hard to find because most people, you know, you're building an agency, you hire an admin, and a lot of times people hire the admin that makes them feel good.
Right.
They tell you, Micah, you're amazing, you're so great, you're this, you're that. It's like, no, I want the person that goes, dude, you're all right, but this right here was messed up.
Right.
Like we do here with the podcast. This thing has been a work in progress, and every once in a while, they have a come into Jesus meeting with me and go, hey, what you're doing here, that's not good. Do more of this. That wasn't right. Like, but I want to hear it because I don't know. But you got to surround yourself with people that where everyone has these blind spots.
Exactly. You don't know what you don't know, and what I will say – again, is don't just stay in the bubble that you're in the company, right? If you're part of whatever agency, right, there are plenty of people at this company who are willing to talk to you and help you. But it's on you to reach out, introduce yourself,
right,
explain what you're going through, and ask. Not everybody's going to say yes. I've had people, hey, you're not in my hierarchy. Sorry, that's fine. I'll go talk to someone else, right? But there are people who are willing to help, and it's on you to find them. And there are lots of sources as well outside the company, courses, books, training, seminars. Invest into that self.
Yeah.
Invest into yourself, right?
Absolutely. You mentioned school. Where'd you go and what'd you study?
So I went to Colgate University, like the toothpaste.
Okay, where's that?
It's in upstate New York,
gotcha.
Just south of Syracuse. There's apparently some connection with the toothpaste and the name, but
okay.
I don't really know it that well.
You didn't go to be a dentist, did you?
No, okay. I didn't. I went into it thinking, hey, you know, I'm going to study psychology, which I actually ended up majoring anyways.
Yeah.
But then I double majored in communications as well. And I never saw myself going into this type of industry.
Why'd you pick psychology?
Back to self-awareness.
Okay.
Right? I mean, I wanted to understand people because I felt like when I went into college, I didn't understand people
Got
very
it.
Well
So
at
not
all.
For a industry per se. You were just
no,
more I want
not
to
at all.
Gotcha.
No, it was for my maybe a little selfish, but like I wanted to understand more about myself and the world and how people work because I felt like I didn't have a good grasp on that.
Yeah.
And so that's what I put down on paper. And I ended up doing that, and it was a great time.
So you did work in that field.
Let me see here. So I ended up doing a double major.
Okay.
So I did a major in behavioral psychology as well as media and communications.
Gotcha.
So When I graduated, I was like, okay, I'm going to go into, you know, maybe some research, maybe film and television. We'll see.
Yeah.
That was in 2019. Things changed in 2020. That's how I ended up finding my practice company and actually really fell in love with the idea of, you know what? I can take that loss that family's feeling on the worst days of their life and make it so they're only grieving emotionally and not financially. And that's a big world of difference for a family that's, you know, might be losing their mortgage, might not have the money to take care of funeral and final expenses. And, you know, I saw that recently with my first death claim. You know, that kind of brought everything full circle for me. And, you know, I've gone 2.5 years almost without a death claim.
Wow.
And that's probably a little longer. I do want to get into
that. Yeah. What initially attracted you to the insurance industry? Like, how did you go from, so you said you were doing some psychology work or whatnot.
Yep.
2020 happened, job's no longer there, right? Yep. And from there, how did you find insurance? Did you look for it specifically? Were you looking just for a sales job?
I was looking online. I was looking on Indeed. I was looking on LinkedIn.
Okay.
ZipRecruiter. And I was just applying to a ton of different positions.
Anything.
Because, you know, I had a time where I was unemployed.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, you know what? I was in school for a while. Let me take a couple months to myself. Just relax a little bit. And then I was like, all right, I can't do this anymore. I need to get back into the workforce. I have dreams and goals that I want to pursue. So I went online and I just started looking at different places, applied here, applied there. And one of the ads caught my eye, you know, benefits representative here. Here's what you can make over, you know, your trajectory here.
Yeah.
And I thought, that sounds kind of interesting. Maybe that can be a place for me to start. This was funny, Mike. So I applied. We had a group interview. There were four of us on, and the interview was at 8 a.m. Saturday morning. Okay, it was on Zoom. Right. All four of us show up. Two of the people are in pajamas. One has their camera off and then I'm looking decent.
Yeah.
Right. So the interview finishes and the hiring manager is like, hey, can you actually stay on for a second? So I stay on. They're like, we want you. I was like, really? I was like, all right, cool. So what do I have to do to get started? Right. Yeah. So we were in training for a couple weeks and, you know, then we got on the phones and I was so anxious starting on my first phone call, sweating, you know, because I never saw myself doing that. I always thought, oh, telemarketer, scam.
Yeah.
That was my mindset.
And was it all virtual sales, telesales?
Virtual sales and telesales. Okay. Yeah. 90,
you never sold prior to that.
Well, I actually did.
Okay.
I actually did, but it was in a completely different line of work. If you're familiar with the company Arbon, they're a company that specializes in health, wellness, beauty supplements.
Okay.
And my best friend at the time got me into that, and I did that for a couple months, but I just couldn't vibe with it because I'm really not using a ton of makeup, right?
Yeah.
but I always knew that I wanted to work for myself.
Okay.
I'm not someone who just can follow a W-2 framework and not chafe at it, right? I've studied independently. I've done independent research projects. I like freedom and I like autonomy.
Yeah.
And so I knew in whatever form I had to find a career that would allow me to do that. And so far, so good.
Gotcha. So you're at this other company for a few months. Mm-hmm. You said you were very anxious hitting the phones. What was it like at first? What was the response? Like, how did you do your first time on the phone?
Poorly, very poorly.
And were you dialing to book appointments? Were you dialing to make one-time closes?
Dialing to book appointments.
Okay.
Yep, I had no idea what a call to close was until I came here.
Gotcha.
Right, so I was dialing to book appointments. The leads were not even interested in what we were talking about.
Okay.
Right, so what ended up happening was I gave it my best for 3-4 months.
Yeah.
Hardly made any money. And at the end of the day, somebody from LinkedIn actually reached out to me. And
wait, I thought they were only fraud on LinkedIn, no? So.
No, apparently not, right? But I started saying, hey, like, wait a second. I'm at this contract rate over here.
Yeah.
Wait, you're telling me I can actually work with people who have expressed interest in insurance?
Yeah.
And I actually own my book of business? And I've got carrier contracts that are double from what I'm getting over here? Maybe worst case scenario, I'll make some money.
Got it. So they reached out to you?
Yep.
Would you have your resume online?
Yep. Reached out to me on LinkedIn.
Yeah.
Started up the conversation and here we are.
Got it. What was it like your first time calling off of actual leads?
I couldn't believe the difference, honestly, because when you're used to that, that's all you know.
Yeah.
Right. And the fact that I could call someone up and say, hey, you know, Bob, looks like you submitted this. Your date of birth is XYZ. Yeah. He's like, yep. And this was about life insurance. Yep. All right, cool. So I'm the underwriter assigned to your file here. Purpose of my call is to schedule an appointment with you. To see if we can help you with these plans. I've got some time today or tomorrow. What's typically best for you? Cool. I show up there. He knows it's about insurance. I don't have to do anything.
Yeah, were you in home in the beginning?
I was.
Yeah.
Yep.
Did you like that or no?
I loved it.
Yeah.
And I still do half and half in home and virtual. Not only for my own enjoyment, but because I want to make sure I'm staying up to date with everything for my team.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely.
So I sat there. It's actually about insurance. I remember my very first appointment too. It was a guy in an apartment. AIG guaranteed issue.
Really?
Yeah.
That was your first FFL appointment.
Very first FFL appointment. Nice, but nice. The guy was super thankful. He was struggling to get coverage, had some complicated medical conditions, and policy still enforced to this day.
Yeah. It was funny you said about the leads, because a lot of times, you know, an agent gets started and they have the same leads and they go, oh man, these people are not interested. There's this, this, and that. But it's, you had a different baseline. Your baseline, the other company, were, it was like bait and switch stuff, right?
Correct.
They're filling out for something that's not life insurance.
Correct.
Now, the thing about life insurance, like, you know, well, how do these companies do that? Everybody needs life insurance. So you could fill out something for, you know, I need to get a new cell phone, I need to get homeowner's insurance. And I'm sure after enough talking and whatever, you can uncover some clients that need protection. But it's a lot harder because there's no intent for life insurance there.
Exactly.
But that was your baseline. Then you get on the leads here, and it's like, these are an improvement. But it's all about mindset, because a
absolutely
different person can come in with the same exact leads. These leads are their baseline. Now, they're not ready to really dial. They don't understand the mindset that needs to go into it. They're so focused on the quality of leads. Give them that same batch. They don't book those appointments. They don't go help that agent with the AIG policy because of this. Mm-hmm. That's so key. But
it is. And listen, that doesn't mean that there aren't different qualities of leads to be aware of, right? If I had started off probably on year-old leads, yeah, I would have had a different result, right? I remember, so when I joined, I put what I had on my credit card to buy my first leads, and I thought, you know what? Worst case scenario, I'll dispute the charge. Best case scenario, I'll make my money back,
there
right?
You go.
But that was my mindset. Like, right. I have to at least break even. If I can at least break even, I can keep going.
Yeah.
And then I will improve over time, and then I will become more profitable over time. And again, not perfect, but we're definitely a lot better where we are right now compared to where we were 2 years ago.
Yeah, and I think a lot of it is due to having that proper positive mindset, that positive mental attitude, because you can look at the same thing and only look at the worst case. Like, I'm big on, let's weigh both options, because you're right. I could have success on these. I could help some families, or I could not. What's the worst thing that happens? Worst thing that happens is I buy all these leads and I don't help a family. Mm-hmm. I'm still alive. I'm still breathing.
Yep.
Everyone's okay. Good. Everything's all right. We can get more chances. There's more leads. There's plenty of leads available. There's plenty of clients, you know, but it goes back to managing this, because if you're not, you know, if you don't have the mental toughness, if you can't push through it, a small thing like not helping a few family, you know, booking 15 appointments, sitting with three, not helping anyone, dude, your business could be over if you don't have the proper perspective. Or you can look at it like, hey, I was due one bad day, right? I did all right last week, did pretty bad this week, so next week's going to be a good one.
Absolutely. And I think the biggest thing that you have to be aware of as a new agent, or even as a seasoned agent, is don't take it personally.
Yeah.
Everybody's going to say no at some form or another. A no right now doesn't mean a no forever.
Absolutely.
Right? But there are always more people to talk to. So don't take it so damn personally, because then you're just making it about you.
100%.
Right? Think about the client, right? And listen, maybe they requested it at that moment, but things change for them. Things change for everybody, right? Maybe somebody else beat you to it. Maybe they thought it was something else. Whatever. The point is, don't take it personally. Keep going. There are more people to talk to who 100%. Actually want your help, and focus on them.
Yep. Now, you mentioned your team. You're building a team, right? Mm-hmm. We have a question from Steve Giordano. So every week we have someone on True Talk. We ask a question for the next guest. So his question to you is, what type of strategies do you have in place to motivate your team, and are you utilizing lock-ins?
Great question. So the strategies that I use to motivate my team are a couple different things. Number one, We do a little bit of an agency bonus ourselves.
Okay.
So we get the managers together. We figure out, all right, so if people on the team hit these numbers, here's what we're going to chip in for a bonus, right?
Gotcha.
So something a little agency specific to provide some motivation. And we're also thinking about rolling out a quarterly trip for our agency as well, but that's still in the works.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's kind of on the agency level, but we never want to forget that vision, right? Here's what you can do. Here's how you can change your life. Here's how you can build something that lasts beyond just you, right? So making sure everybody is plugged into trainings, making sure that people are aware of what works and what doesn't work from a sales psychology perspective, word tracks, and mindset to keep everybody on the same page.
Yeah.
That's something that I wasn't good at starting out, but because I just used to say, okay, well, it's your opportunity, do with it what you want, right? But there wasn't enough structure, and there wasn't enough consistency, and there wasn't enough being on the same page as an agency, and people weren't coming together.
Yeah.
Right? So rolling out more of that has helped my agents to kind of get a little bit more on the same page, and continue to be motivated, and also to share success, right? Like, congratulate each other in GroupMe when we make, you know, when we make a sale. Highlight things that are working, right? New rookies. Highlight people who have good retention.
Yep.
Highlight people who focus more on some things that maybe the average agent doesn't focus on. Hey, you closed an annuity. Awesome. Good for you. Right? You wrote with this carrier that not a lot of people write. Why did you use them? Awesome. Great, great, great job making use of the tools in your portfolio.
Yeah.
So that's kind of on the agency motivation side. On the lock-in side, it's something that I've wanted to get into more, but I haven't been utilizing that as much.
Yeah.
I was actually talking with Eric Schmidt last week, and we're in the process of doing one. Actually, I think it's scheduled the 7th, right? Okay. That's Thursday.
Yep.
So we're going to have one at his office upstairs.
Nice.
Just getting people together, getting around people, working with different people. Because that's the other thing as a team, right? We want to build good culture within the team, but we also want our people to realize that, hey, we're in a company. There are other producers at the company. Reach out to them,
right.
Plug into them, hop on their Zooms.
One big team.
Listen to them, yep. Right? I know corporate has some dial rooms as well that they run. So ask about that stuff, because no one's going to hand it to you on a silver platter. But if you ask, you know, asking, you shall receive.
Right. You know? It's funny because early on you were saying, you know, about getting started. Well, I didn't know this. Nobody told me this. And like the answer to that is what you just said. Ask.
Right.
Hey, you don't know until you ask.
Right.
Because you're right. It is 1099. I'm not going to sit you down and go, Micah, you have to dial tomorrow at 9. You have to use these leads. You have to call me when you're done. Like that. It would be insane because you're a 1099 independent contractor. But ask and you'll receive. The information's out there. You mentioned earlier a death claim. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that I've not met an agent that has not been impacted, you know, mm-hmm. by a death claim. I hate to say positively, but I mean, at the end, we're all going to die. It's no secret, right? It's no spoiler. Like, mm-hmm. And it is part of this business. And I know I can speak from experience that changed my business, delivering my first death check. So you had one, was it recently?
Recently is my first one.
First one.
It was a family that I sat with back in June of 22.
Okay.
Okay. Really nice husband and wife. The request originally came through for mortgage protection, ended up helping the wife with a term policy, husband with a whole life with AmeriCo, given his health. And the policy was enforced for nearly a year. It was like 363 days, okay? And they were on my calendar to, hey, here's your annual check-in. Mm-hmm. How's everything going? So I see that morning, it was a couple weeks ago, death claim filed on this policy, and I was like, no way.
As you're going in to check for the annual review?
That was scheduled for that week.
Yeah.
So that was on a Monday. The annual review, I think, was on Thursday,
gotcha. Roughly.
Okay. So I call her up because it was her husband's policy that the claim was filed on. And I was like, hey, her name was Francesca. I noticed this happened. Like, what happened? Because he seemed to be pretty healthy at the time we wrote on the policy, and she was like, wow, you know, it was just so sudden.
Yeah.
He went in for a checkup. They ended up finding an intestinal blockage, and the doctor told him he had 3 days.
Wow.
And I was like, wow, that's incredible. And she's like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't have money to keep paying the mortgage.
Yeah.
He was the breadwinner. And I was like, wow, so this is bringing it full circle.
Yeah.
Because that's my first experience with it, right? I haven't had a death claim yet, you know, before that one, and so it didn't really hit home for me.
Right.
But calling her up, offering the condolences, you know, going to see her, you know, gathering the policy, obituary, all that stuff that's necessary for filing the claim, and then sending that off to AmeriCo was like, wow, like now the responsibility is on me to deliver that to that family who needs it.
Yeah.
Now, of course, it was in the first 2 years, so it was contestable, so they took a little bit of time, you know, to review the medical records, make sure everything was good, of course, which it was. And what was cool here is the policy was for $10,000. So AmeriCo paid that $10,000. They also paid, I think it was like 8 to 9% interest for the amount of time between when the claim was filed and when the check was paid.
Oh, wow.
So they ended up getting like an extra $240
on
top of that. And I remember calling her and telling her that because she was waiting for a while. And she's like, wow, I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. This is really going to help. You know, I am going to be moving, you know, in with some family, but this is really going to help to offset the losses.
Yeah.
you know, that we had to put, you know, put this stuff on a credit card, right? So always remember that what you do will come full circle at one point or another, whether it's a living benefit, on a term policy, final expense, death claim on a whole life.
What, how much did that change your perspective on what we do? And did you change anything meeting with clients since then?
It did. And I think the biggest thing is it gave me a real example. Because up until that point, I was using other people's examples, right? You have the story of Mark Mead and his aunt, right? Yep. Everybody knows that.
Yep.
And you have other stories from other agents and my uplines as well. But to actually have something real that I can speak to myself, that I can share with my future clients, is something invaluable from that. And that's definitely changed my approach on this business.
Yeah. Like you said, it makes it real. I mean, it's as much as you can, you know, think about it, tell yourself, you understand it, but until you actually experience that phone call of, hey, so-and-so passed away, it's like I've had more than a handful, and it's like, you know, it'd be a client you don't even remember, but once they make that call, you hear the, you know, the beneficiary's voice, and you kind of mentally go back to the appointment, it brings it full circle, and you're like, it shows you how important what we do is. It, you know, we get caught up in the training, the podcast, the commission, the trips, all this stuff, right, the leads, my next appointment, and then this stuff kind of makes time stand still for a minute and realize, like, it is a big deal what we do. We do make a major impact on every family we sit down with. And that's why it's so important. Like, you know, it's not just about closing clients. It's about putting serving something families, in force that wasn't, serving them with something that they didn't have prior to you meeting them. I mean, that $10,000, it's like, it might as well have been $1 million.
Right.
Because they didn't have it before. And how much is that going to help? And whatever they do, the move, this, that, the burial, but like you said, they're still going to grieve. There's still someone passing away. It still is an emotional event. But if we can remove the financial strain from it, then we're doing something pretty positive for these families.
Absolutely. And, you know, as somebody who had financial strain growing up and whose parents, you know, weren't too big on the idea of life insurance, it's not something that I, up until that point, really saw come full circle.
Right.
Right. And again, I've heard of it from other people, and there's only so much that you can take from someone else's story until it becomes personal
Absolutely.
For yourself. So that was the major way in which that impacted my business. And now I have a story where if they tell me, oh, you know what, I don't need it. Well, hold on a second. Right. Do you have that, you know, sitting in an account just ready to go?
Yeah.
Most people don't.
Right.
Right. That we sit with. Most people don't. And so, listen, even if you do, would you rather use your money or the insurance company's money?
Right.
Right.
Yeah, it almost gives you more confidence in just saying those statements, because you're right. Up until this point, you were saying those based off what everyone else is telling you. Now you lived it. You got to see it firsthand.
Absolutely.
It's a big deal. So we have next week, we got Kayla Rojo coming up.
All right, Kayla. So here's the question that I've got for you. What do you think is the biggest obstacle in your present business? And what are you going to do in the next 30 days to overcome that obstacle?
I like that. That's a good question. Good stuff. Well, dude, I appreciate you coming in. I like to end with something fun usually.
Okay? Yeah.
I'm going to throw one wild at you. I don't know what your answer is going to be, but
I feel
like people have hidden talents, hobbies that nobody knows about. What's something that you have that nobody knows? Whether it's you like something obscure, you got a hidden talent, you play the ukulele. I don't know. What is it? Give me something fun.
All right. So this is going to go back to my high school talent show.
Okay.
Okay. And I was such a big nerd in high school.
Okay.
Okay. And that's carried over into my business in terms of like understanding carriers, products, comp, all that. But my high school talent show, I was like, all right, we've got people playing the piano, violin, singing, like cool stuff. I was like, all right, I want to do something different.
Yeah.
All right. So if you're familiar with the number pi, right?
Yeah.
It's the circumference of a circle divided by the right diameter, right? So I was like, all right, let me memorize some digits of pi. So what I ended up doing was I memorized 200 digits of pi.
Oh, my God.
And it took me probably 3 to 4 days to get it down, but it almost becomes very rhythmic.
Yeah.
You're just kind of reciting it to yourself.
Are you going to recite it now?
I it's kind of faded. I could go a little bit, but yeah, went up there, recited it perfectly, and it was the only time I'd ever seen that in a talent show. So that's my weird little fun
fact.
That's
awesome, dude.
But
can you give us like the first 10 digits?
3.14159265358979323 8462643383. It's kind of fading, but
we're gonna check.
I know that was a little bit more than 10 digits.
Naomi, check that when you edit this, and let us know if he got it right. Well, that is, I was not expecting that. Well, good stuff, dude.
Yeah.
If I ever need to know anything about pie, I will definitely give you a call.
Please do.
My daughter texted me on 3/14, said something about pie, and I didn't even realize what date it was. I was like,
"Yeah,
what are you talking about?" She's like, "Mom said you would know this."
Yeah. No, for sure. But we all have our weird talents and quirky fun facts. And that's something that's a little bit different. Oh, yeah, I play the violin or I like this. But, like, there you go.
Nobody was expecting that.
Surprise, surprise.
Yeah. Well, good stuff, dude. I appreciate you coming in. I really do.
Thanks,
appreciate
Mike.
Appreciate the talk and what you bring to the table. And I just love that concept of being accountable, being self-aware, taking care of what you can control. It's like when I got started in this business, the first lesson Sean gave me was that focus on what you can control. You can't control who fills out the lead. You can't control what the carriers do. You can't control what happens on your way to the appointment. You can control your mindset, your attitude, your activity. If you focus on that and only that, you should be able to achieve what you want to achieve here.
Absolutely. Well said. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Thanks for downloading and watching. Tune in next week. We'll find out Kayla's answer to this question. We'll keep this thing rolling. We'll be here every week on True Talk. See you.